partner she is and how supportive she is. And just, I can't put it into words. And sometimes the greatest truth in our life is like that. We can't explain. We can't put them into words. And one of those great truths for us as Christians is this truth of the Trinity, that our one God exists in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And really, I'm not going to spend this morning trying to explain the Holy Trinity. If I did try that, I would fail. It is impossible to do. Any attempts to explain this Trinity, this Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three in one God, is futile. It can't really be done. Who God is beyond our comprehension. St. Augustine said, if you can understand it, it's not God. And I believe there's truth in that. We can't understand it. But today is Holy Trinity Sunday. Something must be said. So there's two things I want to say this morning about the Holy Trinity, why it's important that we believe in God as the one God who exists in three persons. The first thing is that God is always with you. God is with in himself. Exists in this relationship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our prayer earlier says that they live in this community of joy and love through eternity. But also, the second thing is that God, because he exists in this relationship always, calls us to follow him in that we are called to live in relationship with the world. So we're going to talk about that a little bit today. The word with might be one of the most important words in the Bible. And I think it's the key to understanding Trinity as well as we can understand it. We know that in John 1 it says that in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was with God. Proverbs says that when God fixed the foundations of the earth, I was there, delighting to be with the children of God. Matthew 28, our gospel today, Jesus says, and I am with you to the end of the age. He says this to his disciples after commissioning them to take part in his ministry, to carry his ministry forward. In worship, we begin our prayers, the Lord be with you. We do that, we're trying to get everybody to be quiet. The Lord be with you. And everybody needs to be quiet. We also proclaim that the Word became flesh and dwelt with us. We learn from John's gospel. Around Advent and Christmas, we talk about Jesus and we use the word or the name Emmanuel, which means God with us. And at the beginning of each worship service, we have a greeting that we all know that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, or the communion of the Holy Spirit, be with you. You know, when I teach Christian theology at Lenore Ryan, we spend the first day doing one thing. I don't know what the name of this game is, but I play a game with the students. And how I start that game, and usually there's about 30, I've had as many as 32 students in class, and I start the game by saying, I'm Ryan. I came here on a rhinoceros. Now, I really didn't do that. But this is a game to learn names. So what we're doing is I'll say my name, and then some sort of a mode of transport that begins with the first letter of my name. So Steve, who might be the first one that I come to, will say, I'm Steve. I rode here in a Saturn. And then Anne behind him may have ridden in on either an aardvark or an accord or something. But by the time we made our way across the room, the thing that makes it so difficult is each person, when it gets to Anne not only has to say, I'm Anne, I rode here on an accord or in an accord, she has to say, and this is Steve who rode here in Saturn, this is Ryan who rode here in a rhinoceros. So you can imagine when you get to your 32nd student and they're having to introduce everybody else in class, it kind of gets a little tense and people want to forget some names. But don't feel sorry for the 32nd student, because what I always do at the end is then I introduce everybody in the class. By doing that game, I learn everybody's name in class the first day. And it's not just a wasted class, it's not just so that I can go without preparing a God calls us to be in relationships because you are important to God. It's important to understand this class you were in because we're studying about the God that we that believes in relationships are important. So we do that every year. It's a great thing. So Paul would stay after service today. We'll play that game. Everybody's name name. But it's really important. It's really important to understand that God is with us. Very, very important. Now, God's not always for us. We wish that God was always for us. But sometimes that we're heading in directions and we are for things that God is not for. We all know we veer off the path sometimes. And God's not always for us, but God is always with us. We can be sure of that. And as God is always with us, we are called, just like those disciples in the gospel text this morning, who were commissioned to go and make disciples of all nations, we are called and commissioned to be with the world, to be with the world in ministry. Now, again, we have to be careful, because we're not actually called to do for all the time. We're not called to do for everyone that we meet who needs help. But we are called to be with the world, as much as we are called to be for the world. Now, if you look at our gospel, I hope you do, it's a short gospel today. And you'll see in verse 19, Jesus is talking to his disciples. This is kind of his farewell speech in the gospel of Matthew. He's just maybe convinced them that he's resurrected and that kind of thing. They're having a hard time wrapping their minds around that. But in verse 19, he gives this great statement. He says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you." Jesus set us up today to do a great three-point sermon. Make disciples, baptize them, and teach them. But if we were to do that, if we were just to do exactly that, we would miss the point. Actually, we'd miss the first point. Because if you start at the beginning of verse 19, you see, what's that word, the first word? Go. That's actually our first point. It's a four-point sermon. We skip over to the next because we're good. We're good at making disciples of all nations, baptizing them, teaching them. We do that in the church. It's what we're good at. What's harder for us is to go. Now, people would come to us. You know, they would come to this place where we're comfortable, what was familiar, we'd be fine. You know, people would listen to the kind of music that we like, and the kind of music that we have in worship, that we'd be fine. If they would only like the kind of instruments that we normally use in worship, we'd be fine. You know, if they used the same words and had the same traditions, you know, if they dressed like us and they gave their offering like we did, if they could do all these things, if they, in other words, if they would come to us, then we'd be all right. This go presents a real challenge for us. Because when Jesus calls us to go, he's saying, go. He's saying, go to be where they are. Go to be where they are comfortable. Or make your place comfortable for them. Go learn their language. Go try their music. Go listen to what they have learned. Go make new traditions based on their traditions. Go to them. The go part is really, really hard. I tell you what messed up for us. It was that Kevin Costner movie, Field of Dreams. Build it and they will come. Doesn't apply to the church, okay? That's not Jesus' dream, all right? It's go. Go make disciples. And understand that it's not literally that we always have to be pounding the pavement, going door to door, going proclaiming the gospel in the alleyways. It's not really all this is. Going can take place in this room, right here. It can take place right here. Going is when a visitor comes in, a new visitor, and we think, maybe they don't know this service. And we go, we get up from that pew that our grandparents sat in and carved their names in with a pocket knife or something, you know, 150 years ago. We go and sit with them and help them do the service. If it's a single mother or a single dad and they're fighting with kids, we go and sit with them and see if we can't help them. if it's someone they're heading out and we grab them after service and say, hey, let me take you to lunch. I'd like to get to know you better. That's going. That's also going, even though we're not technically leaving the building. We go to them. We go to make things comfortable for them. You know, because God is with us, and God is always with us, we are called to be with the world. We're called to go to make disciples, to be with people where they are. I have one final story. In July of 2001, my wife and I went on a youth mission trip. We were kind of leaders for this youth mission trip. We went to New York City. And one day, or one evening actually, we went to Harlem. And it was in an area that was pretty bad. They let us out right in front of the building, and they wouldn't park the van there. They were afraid to leave the van there where it could be robbed or whatever. They took the van. They said, we'll come back to get you in a couple hours. And when we walked into this building, there was two couples there, obviously not from this area, but they had set up a mission there, right in this neighborhood. And one of the couples was downstairs with the adults and having a worship service. But upstairs, there was one couple was with the youth. And it was so interesting to see the way they were going to make disciples. In a sense, people were coming to them because they set up this mission and people were coming. And everyone who was there pretty much just walked there to the mission. But we got to spend time with these 50 kids in this Harlem neighborhood, and they were wild. I mean, these are the wildest kids. I saw one kid punch another kid right in the face, and they just acted like this is just, you know, kind of shrugged it off, whatever. This is just the way of life there. And we did all kinds of fun things, games and skits, and there was like a little puppet theater and things like this. But there was this one point in the service where they had the message where they wanted to talk about, where they wanted to share the gospel. And the lady there who was running this, she had learned, remember last week I talked about language of the heart? She had learned the language of these kids' hearts. And these were wild, loud, rowdy kids. But through, it was probably about 10 minutes, those kids did not move. They did not make a sound. They didn't even look at things out of their periphery. They just looked forward like this. And she had learned their language. And you know what that language was? It was not Liverpool, by the way. It was candy. Okay? She had a candy bar this big. Or I think she had three of them. And she said, the three kids who were the quietest get these candy bars at the end of the service. And I'll never forget that. And one of my youth, he was kind of rowdy himself, and he kept poking at this one kid trying to get him to do something. And he just sat there like this the whole time. But they go. And we're called to go to learn those languages, to get out of our comfort zones. We've heard the gospel. The gospel has already made a difference in our lives. And yes, we need to continue to hear the gospel. We need it as often as we can. We need to come to the table and receive forgiveness, life, and salvation as often as possible. We need to live into these sort of discipleship habits. But we already got to that gospel. That in some way intensifies this command to go, to take it to those who haven't received the gospel in the way that we have. God is with. That's the most we can say about the Trinity, that God is always in relationship, even within Himself, but God is also with.